Good afternoon, everyone. Today, in memory of the 15-year anniversary of the Columbine High School Massacre, we'd like to give a better explanation of the events of the incident and its impact towards the ones who experienced it. 15 years ago, a terrible incident occurred at Columbine High School in Columbine, Colorado. 13 loved ones were killed, and many were injured. This tragic school event was one of the most violent school events in history. Its actions have impacted the people who experienced it, and schools across the United States as well. So what happened in April 20, 1999? A shooting at Columbine High School in Littleton, Colorado, took place by two people. Eric Harris, age 18, and Dylan Klebold, age 17. On April 20, 1999, they entered Columbine High School with semi-automatic rifles, pistols, and several explosives. In less than 20 minutes, they killed 12 fellow students and a teacher and wounded 21 others. The violence came to an end when Harris and Klebold took their own lives. Officials later found out that two propane tank bombs were placed in the cafeteria. Had they detonated, the death toll would have been much, much higher. So luckily, those were stopped. Now, the timeline of the event. 11:19, the shooting begins. 11:19 through 11:29, the shooters enter through the west entrance of the school, moving towards the library. From 11:29 to 11:36, the library shootings take place. From 11:36 to 12:08, the shooters wander the high school, firing guns and setting off bombs. 12:08, the shooters take their lives as well. Why they committed the crime? It's still unknown exactly why Eric and Dylan went on the shootings. Rumors still exist today that the killers wanted to commit suicide, they had people on their blacklist, etc. The list goes on and on. Of course, these are just rumors, these are not facts. The aftermath of the crime. In the days immediately following the shootings, it was speculated that Harris and Klebold purposely chose athletes, minorities, and Christians as their victims. It initially was reported that one student, Cassie Bernal, was asked by one of the gunmen if she believed in God. When she said yes, she was shot to death. Her parents later wrote a book titled She Said Yes, honoring their daughter. However, it later was determined that the question was not posed to Bernal, but to another student who was already wounded by a gunshot. When the victim replied yes, the shooter walked away. Subsequent investigations determined Harris and Klebold chose their victims randomly, and the two teams originally had intended to bomb their school, potentially killing hundreds of people. There was speculation that Harris and Klebold committed the killings because they were members of a group of social outcasts called the Trench Coat Mafia that was fascinated by goth culture. It also was speculated that Harris and Klebold had carried out the shootings as retaliation for being bullied. Additionally, violent video games and music were blamed for influencing the killers. However, none of these theories were proven. Through journals left behind Harris and Klebold, investigators eventually discovered the teens had been planning for a year to bomb the school in an attack similar to the 1995 Oklahoma City bombings. Investigative journalist Dave Cullen, author of the 2009 book Columbine, described Harris as the callously brutal mastermind, while Klebold was a quivering depressive who journaled obsessively about love and attended the Columbine prom 3 days before opening fire. Now, I'd like to welcome Cecilia, who will explain what she witnessed in the scene. Could you tell us, please, what you witnessed?
Well, I was 15 on the day of Columbine, and I was a sophomore at Columbine High School. I want you to close your eyes, and I want everyone watching to just close your eyes, and I don't want you to listen to what happened to me. I want you to experience. So I was in the library, and I was with my best friend, and we were studying for a U.S. history test. The library was completely silent, but about halfway through the review, we heard a pop. And we didn't think anything of it until it was followed by four more pops. Our first reaction was to run to the window. And so we looked over, libraries on the second floor, and we saw two guys throwing pipe bombs at cars. That freaked us out, but what freaked us out even more was when they pulled out guns. They didn't stop with the bombs, they took their gun and they started running. And as they ran, it didn't matter if you were white, or if you were black, or if you were Christian or Jewish, they were just shooting everyone who's in the path. Once they got into the school, that was when our teacher told us to go under the tables. That was all we could really do at the time. And she called 911, and we got to wait. And as we waited, we just heard screams and gunfire. To this day, I still can't decide which was scarier, having to sit and wait and listen to all the victims, or when they actually got to the library. Once they entered the library, they started shooting everyone they saw. And the only times they would stop was when someone would start to beg for their life. We just sat there and waited. And that was when my best friend fell asleep. And I thought it was the strangest thing that she could fall asleep amidst the shooting and the craziness that was happening. But once I tried to wake her up, that was when I realized that she wasn't sleeping. Because part of sleeping is waking up, and she wasn't going to be doing that. I think that the more time that passes from an event, the more distance we give ourselves from it. And it becomes just part of history, not something that actually happened. When in reality, that was a real thing, and the people, they're not just a number. People that were killed, they're not just a number. Those are people who went to school that day, you know, expecting to come home. They have moms, they have dads, they have siblings, they have friends. Although that happened 15 years ago, that's still what I think about every night before I go to sleep. Columbine, I know, has changed my life, and it's changed, obviously, everyone who was at the high school that day's life. It's changed the entire community's life, and it's honestly all over the country. It was felt the effects of it. It was awful, but it brought us together, and it's something that has shaped who I am today.
Thank you very much. Hopefully you will never experience something like that again. We would like to now welcome Melissa, the psychologist who's been analyzing the event since it happened. She'll give us the details on the psychological state of the boys before and during the shootings.
I'm going to start with Eric Harris, who, as you stated, was definitely the mastermind in all of this. He had this horrifying superiority complex. He thought he was God. He wrote in numerous journals that he just wished that he could officially be God, so he could literally tell everyone that he was better than them. He drew swastikas in his journals. He planted bombs near his house that were actually found and reported, but never taken in front of a judge beforehand. Friends, parents reported him as well, and none of those affidavits made it in front of a judge. He was angry, yes, but never bullied. He may have been bullied like the average high schooler on occasion for this and that, but never more than the average child. He was a terrific liar. He would play well-behaved and well-mannered in front of adults and teachers, but around peers and on his blogs, he posted how to build bombs and how to cause havoc and how to hurt people without killing them. Dylan was, I'm not going to say a victim because he killed people as well, but he was dying for attention. He wanted that more than anything in this world. He was actually in love with someone, he claimed in some journals, and wrote letters to a girl that he claimed to be in love with. which is why we believe he went to prom 3 days before. He was terribly insecure. He thought no one liked him. He thought no one wanted him around, including his parents and family. And he just happened to find Eric, who told him everything he wanted to hear and told him that this was what was best for the both of them. And he was just along for the ride in all reality. Eric planned everything. They actually found a note that had their schedule for the day from time frame to time frame, like the one you discussed earlier. But at the very end, it said, have fun. They planned to kill thousands that day. There was 2 car bombs, one in Eric's car and one in Dylan's, that were supposed to kill paramedics and reporters and parents after the propane tank bombs in the cafeteria and the kitchen went off. Those propane tanks would have brought the second story floor down, and anyone running away would have been picked off by the 9mm and carbines that they had in their bags. They carried 8 or 9 knives with them. They had over 99 explosives, like the pipe bombs that Cecilia mentioned earlier. They planned to kill as many people as possible that day. And because of Eric, who thought he was wonderful at everything, poorly wired all of those bombs, none of them detonated that day. And if they had, they would have killed everyone in that cafeteria. He was so angry at everyone for not realizing that he was the best. He was the most amazing thing to ever grace the face of this earth. His t-shirt that they found him in said natural selection, which refers to survival of the fittest. What they did that day was not natural selection. Dylan, of course, completely insecure, his shirt said wrath. He was angry at people for not paying attention to him, for not loving him. But in his journals, he drew hearts as opposed to the swastikas and hearts. They were 2 completely different people who just happened to meet and commit one of the most horrifying shootings in a school in all time.
I have a question though. Did you mention that they were abused by their parents?
No, they were not. Their parents were involved, they were caring, they had no idea. Other parents suspected things, but the police department never brought it before a judge for them to search the house or anything else. The house was searched about 7 months after the shooting. All right.
Well, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay. We have a video of an interview, as you see here. First of all, this is a picture of people every year visiting their loved ones at the memorial. And I'd like to play this video.
It's been more than 13 years since Craig Scott found himself frozen with fear on the library floor during the shooting rampage at Columbine High School. Craig survived. His sister Rachel did not.
I found out the next morning. It was confirmed that she was dead.
The nation met Craig, then a 16-year-old sophomore, 2 days after the massacre, when he appeared on the Today Show.
My sister was a real person. She really had a lot of ambition, and I loved her a lot.
In the year following Rachel's murder, Dateline spent time with Craig and his family as they tried to cope with their immeasurable loss.
I didn't get to say goodbye to her physically. I didn't even say anything when she dropped me off at school.
In public, Craig displayed courage as he traveled across the country, sharing his story with thousands of students. But privately, he was haunted by terrifying flashbacks, especially after dark. Using a handheld camera in the spring of 2000, Craig chronicled a desperate attempt to escape his nightmares. The lowest point came soon after our cameras left. Craig and his brother Michael were watching a movie on TV. A violent scene triggered another flashback, and Craig snapped.
The next thing I knew, I picked up my brother, my little brother, who I love. I carried him to the kitchen. I slammed him against the kitchen floor. I pulled out a knife. I put it in front of his face, and I said, "You want to know what it feels like to almost lose your life?"
It was a terrifying moment, but also a turning point in Craig's life. He decided he had to let go of his anger. The first step was also the hardest, forgiving Rachel's killers.
Forgiveness was like setting a prisoner free and then finding out that prisoner is you. Columbine was the worst day of my life, but now looking back, I can be almost thankful in a way for going through such a hard thing, because it's made me who I am today.
Craig Scott now joins us. Thank you so much for being here, Craig. What does it take for people to overcome to recover from a tragedy such as this one?
Well, I think it definitely takes a lot of time. I mean, for me, it took, I think, 10 years to really get back to a real healed place. I still miss my sister, but I have friends that were there. Richard Costaldo, who's with my sister, who's in a wheelchair and paralyzed, who still is going through a lot of healing and still has a long ways to go. So it really is a long process, but I do think that there are things that can help in the healing process. I think that I was blessed enough to have family and faith to surround me. I think people stepping in from the community. I mean, I remember my mom having to look after me and deal with the loss of her daughter, and people, neighbors bringing meals. I think that remembering the loved ones and remembering the good things about Rachel, the good things that she did, focusing on something positive. I think there's going to be people that are real angry and are going to want to do something with that anger, and I hope they can channel it to something that's positive. I know for me, for years, I held on to such hatred towards the shooters. They had no right to do what they did, killed innocent people, that did them no harm. And it started to really take a toll on me and affect the way that I treated people as I carried around the anger. And so part of my healing process was forgiving and letting go.
Forgiving.
I'm just talking about my healing process, and I think that it's not saying what someone did is okay. It's a letting go of, so that you can be moved on. There's a quote that forgiveness is like setting a prisoner free and finding out that prisoner is you. And I felt like I was that prisoner. That was part of my process, being able to, for those that have faith, I grew deeper in that, and that was part of my healing process. But one of the biggest things that helped me get through was just seeing something good come from losing my friends and losing my sister and going through. And I truly hope that what's happened here at this theater, that there can be some amazing, immense, good, positive things, a movement, something that can come out of this. And I hope that the people that went through this can become unified. Don't let this shooter steal anything from you. And so that would be my input.
Your lips to God's ears. Thank you so much. This is amazing.
As you can see here, this individual who lost his sister, as well as many other people, were affected greatly by this incident. But they also tried to get a benefit of it. So as you see here, he has experience. He learned to forgive people. And it's not just, you know, the people who have experience. Now you'll notice, you know, this tragic school event was, you know, again, one of the most violent school events in history. Its actions have impacted the people who experienced it, as well as schools across the U.S. Today, the benefits are, as we mentioned earlier, the schools are basically taking their security much more seriously. So you'll find people are, the principal is encouraging teachers to, around schools, the principals are encouraging their teachers to do their routines, do the daily routines more with their students, so they can be prepared when situations like these happen. Students will hopefully never experience anything close to this situation again. The Columbine High School Massacre. Thank you. Some final points. teachers, and